Hello, everyone. Super excited to be here. I'm Hakim. I do front-end development, and I work on projects of great consequence, like this one, which is a grid of checkboxes. And when you uncheck a checkbox, it generates a wave of unchecking checkboxes. And when you check a checkbox, it generates a wave of checking checkboxes. So forth, so on. I really like taking something which is inherently very boring, like a checkbox, and trying to do something fun with it. And I noticed that this is something of a recurring theme in a lot of my projects. This is a Christmas tree that I made out of form elements a while back. So that's all using CSS transforms and transitioning around, which means it's all interactive as well, and you can actually type into those input fields, et cetera, which is a fun side effect. So looking back at many of the projects that I've worked on, I've realized that I really like the process of breaking apart interface elements, thinking about how they work, what their individual components are, how those components could be altered and improved and just used differently, sometimes in surprising ways, but other times in more useful ways too. So this whole curiosity really started when I got into working with front-end development, which I did in Flash. And at the time, you know, working in Flash, you pretty much had nothing to get started with. There was no real built-in components. The ones that existed, even very fundamental things like a scroll bar or a dropdown, worked so very poorly that you kind of had to go off and write your own versions. So everybody, I mean, take a scroll bar, for example, then, right? Everybody pretty much went off and wrote their own scroll bars. And that sounds like a really terrible idea, and is a terrible idea for almost everybody, except the people who actually went through the process of building their own scroll bars. Because when you think about it, we all know how a scroll bar works. Superficially, from having used enough of them, you understand that the height of the scroll handle versus the height of the scroll bar track represents the height of content you're seeing versus the total amount of content, et cetera. But when you start assembling your own scroll bar from the ground up and you start really thinking through all of the decisions that are involved in that process, you start learning that there's a lot more nuance and a lot of more room, for, I think, for improvements for things to just be done differently. So like, what happens when you click on the scroll bar track? How far does the scroll bar jump? Does it jump a tenth of the distance towards you? Does it jump all the way to you, to the center of the cursor or the closest edge? The arrow keys, how do they work? Is it a fixed pixel scroll or is it a full page, et cetera? And there's just so many different options, and I thought it was very eye-opening going through this process to realize how many opportunities there are to actually go differently and change something about those core interactions that I had never, ever thought to really question before. They were kind of just elements that were always the same and worked the same way, right? So, of course, today, there's a lot more ready-made components to work with. If you're working in a browser, there's better built-in components, and you can customize them more, et cetera. So there's no need to go off and build your own scroll bars. But I think that's a little bit sad, because that process really taught the people who went through it, that exercise kind of taught you to identify things that can be improved in places where people aren't really looking. So I still think it's really valuable to every now and again go back and kind of reinvent the wheel, counterintuitive as it may sound, to build maybe your own drop-down menu. Maybe it's going to come out worse than the original drop-down or the built-in version. Most likely it will. But you will gain your own unique experience from it, and things that can be learned from not just from using drop-downs, but from actually implementing it on your own. When I'm not out building Christmas trees out of form elements, I run my company, which is called Slides, and running my own business for a while has meant I've been able to manage my own time, for better or worse, and I've really splurged on front-end R&D and trying to do these deep dives into very niche areas of RUI, what other people might call implementation details, to try to find those small improvements to these components that we've stopped questioning, I think. So I wanted to highlight a few of those next that I've been exploring lately and share some of the things that came out of it. The first one that I wanted to talk about is hover menus. This is a UI pattern that a lot of people tend to stay away from for really good reasons. But I think if they're implemented in the right way, they're actually incredibly useful. The reason why you try to stay away from them is you have enough experiences of kind of trying to go over a button where a menu appears, and then you try to reach the menu, but the menu goes away before you can get there, which is understandably very, very frustrating. And there are multiple different ways to solve that problem. What I did when I implemented this in slides is to just use a timeout. I think this is the most common solution to this problem. You just, when you leave the button to go to the menu, you start a timeout for 300 milliseconds, say, where the menu remains visible and allows you to kind of cross the gap to the menu. That still has two major trade-offs. Number one is if you're in a dense area with multiple buttons, you're trying to just go somewhere and you cross over this button, there's going to be this menu popping out, which is kind of just frozen into place for 300 milliseconds, which looks like a glitch to me. And then you have, the second thing is you're still left off to the speed of the user. If the user moves too slowly, menu is still going to go away. And you only still have this problem. So you could increase the timeout, which makes the laggy glitch effect worse, and so forth, so on. So I decided to try to explore better options for this for slides, and I wanted to show you, some of what I came up with. First off, this is slides.com/wireframe, which is my personal poor man's design system for slides, where I've got my components. This is the menu we just saw now. But if I try to reach the menu in our current implementation, you'll see that the menu never ends up going away. And what I ended up doing is I actually draw dynamic hit areas depending on where that button and the menu are positioned. So to better show you what I mean, I'm going to switch to another tab where, if you wanted to try this, it's just slides.com/wireframe?debug=2, which turns on a debug mode. And that debug mode will show you what the hit area actually looks like for this menu. So instead of using a timeout, I started drawing this hit area using SVG. It's a dynamically generated SVG depending on the specific size and position of the button and the menu. And I think that turned out to be a very flexible solution for this. It will work in any given direction, upwards or downwards or to the side, et cetera. And because it's drawn dynamically, it has another major benefit. You never really know where a menu is going to appear. Maybe it's scrolled to the top edge of the screen. And in that scenario, it's still going to work, and it's still going to draw itself in a suitable way, depending on that specific position. And even more so, if you try to scroll it while it's visible, it's actually going to redraw the SVG to show you exactly how to update according to the current conditions. So I was really happy with that solution, and I wanted to show you how that could be done in a pretty simplified way. There's more logic in my real implementation, but first off, we've got our SVG element. It has three nodes inside of it, two rectangles. Those are just there to illustrate the position of the button and the menu. In the real-world scenario, those are actually not there at all. They're just HTML elements in the DOM somewhere. And then we have our path, which is what we're going to be using to draw the hit area. Now, for this to work, if you place an SVG at the top of the page, that would be capturing all of your mouse events. So the whole rectangular SVG would be clickable, which would defeat the whole purpose, because then the path can't be our hit area. So we have to disable pointer events on the SVG, and then we can enable them specifically for that inner path element, which means now only the path that we're drawing is going to be our hit area. Then we've got a little bit of JavaScript at dotCSS. First off, we get the bounding boxes for the button and the menu. So that's the X and Y position, the width and the height of those two elements. Then we set the path data, or the path drawing commands, if you will, for that SVG node. If you've never really looked underneath the hood a lot on SVG and how that works underneath the hood, drawing commands are pretty straightforward. It's just a drawing operator followed by the input values that you want to draw. So uppercase M, move to the top left corner of the button, and then uppercase Q, draw a quadratic curve to the top left corner of the menu. Then we'd go straight down by the height of the menu, inwards by another quadratic curve to the bottom left corner of the button. And then there's a slight bit of weirdness. So instead of just closing the path here, I actually draw around the button, so this way the button itself is excluded from the hit area. The reason for that is now the button can still, you know, be reached through the UI, so we're not blocking the button itself. If you were to have like a click handler or something on that button, you can still reach it. And also the reason for why it's a curved line instead of a just diagonal line, if you have a dense area where multiple elements are stacked on top of each other, multiple buttons kind of in a stack, and you draw just a diagonal line, straight line, then you would be covering a lot of the sibling or adjacent elements. So that's why it's a curved line instead. Right, so moving on. The next little UI refinement I wanted to talk about is to do with scroll shadows, which kind of became a thing when Mac or everybody decided to remove scroll bars, which I think is great. It cleaned up the UI nicely, but somebody clever came up with the idea for just using a little shadow to kind of indicate when something critical can be scrolled, when it's not obvious. And I thought that worked really well. We used that in slides in multiple places. But I think it can be implemented in many different ways, some good, some bad. This kind of static version, which you're seeing now, is not the greatest implementation because it's just always there. And if you hit the bottom, you scroll to the bottom, it doesn't make sense because there's no overflow anymore. So the slightly better version of this is to have a shadow that is smart enough to come on and off depending on if there is overflow or if there is no overflow. Now at least, you know, it's only there when there's something to scroll to. But I tinkered more with this for slides, and what we use is a fully dynamic shadow instead, which is a very small refinement to this UI, but I think actually makes it a lot better. So instead of the shadow just coming on and off, it's actually adapting its strength based off of how much overflow there is. So now, even though you aren't going to be, you know, it's not a scroll bar replacement, it helps you kind of locate yourself if you've scrolled, you know, like a quarter of the way down. You can see at a glance that you've hit a quarter of the way down because of the strength of those two shadows. It's also just a lot less jarring than a shadow coming on at full blast. So if you've scrolled, you know, 10, 20 pixels down, the shadow at the top is going to be super faint, which makes sense because there's almost nothing to scroll to. So you don't want to draw your attention towards that direction. And I think this is a really straightforward technique, but it really improves that specific part of the UI. So I wanted to talk about how that's done and how it can be done, which is actually really straightforward. First off, we've got some HTML, or content element, which you know, is where we'll be scrolling, which has the content. It's just overflow auto and a width and a height. Outside of that, we have a wrapper. We need this because we're going to be applying our shadow as before and after pseudo elements on that wrapper. And for that to work, the wrapper needs to be positioned relatively, so our shadows are relative to where the wrapper is. And also, the wrapper, you know, it's a box-level element. It would span the width of its parents, which would be wider than the content, which would make the shadows wider than the content, which we do not want. So we can use min content to set the wrapper to its minimum intrinsic, or sorry, to the minimum intrinsic width of its children, which in this case there's only one child. That child's minimum width is 200 pixels, so now our wrapper is 200 pixels. Nice, convenient way to do that. And then we have our shadows, which are, like I said, before and after pseudo elements on the wrapper. There's not a lot of interesting things happening here. The shadows are not actual shadows, they're linear gradients instead, which is a cheaper way to draw a shadow instead of using, you know, a filter or anything like that. The interesting bit is our custom property, which is what we use to actually control the strength of the shadow. So that's a property called scroll progress, which ranges from 0 to 1. 0 means we haven't scrolled at all. 1, we've scrolled all the way down to the bottom. For the bottom shadow, we used to use the same value, but we use calc to flip it around. So now it's 1 at the top and 0 at the bottom. And then, again, tiny bit of JavaScript. We have our scroll event listener, which we need to monitor the scrolling of that content element, and we need to feed our scroll progress down to the CSS. So the calculation of that is actually very straightforward. We find the scroll range by looking at the total height of all the content. We subtract from that the height that we're already seeing, the visible viewport of the content. And then we divide the current scroll position by that range. We have a 0 to 1 value, which we can set using style set property on that wrapper. So now it's a local custom property on that wrapper, so we can have multiple lists scroll, you know, independently. And it's kind of zoomed out there, but you can see how it works. And that's really all it takes to implement that, which is pretty straightforward. Right, next up, transform anchors. You know those little things that you grab when you resize something in a graphical editing interface, which is what I work on a lot. For the most part, it's very straightforward in terms of what the expectations are from a user point of view, like how they should behave. But there's a lot more interesting parts to implementing them and challenges. And I've worked a great deal on that. And there's been one thing which really annoyed me about this recently that I decided to try to do something about. And the thing that annoyed me is whenever I resize one of our elements to get small enough, the transform anchors kind of start overlapping each other, making it pretty much impossible to reach a specific anchor or even see the content anymore, which is not very helpful. And then I got into thinking, and I realized that this is a part of a UI that I've kind of mimicked from other editors that I've used before. And this is a problem that pretty much exists everywhere else as well that I've worked with. This is Photoshop on the right. The left side is the slides editor that we built. And it's just always kind of been a problem. I just mimicked my implementation off of other implementations, as I usually do, I guess. But just because something has always been that way, which is kind of the point I'm trying to get across today, it doesn't mean that it can't change, that you can't be curious about trying to improve it or do it differently. So I went off and experimented a little bit with this. And the solution I came up with was to dynamically offset the transform anchors depending on the size of the blocks. When it gets small enough, you offset the handles outwards. And that way, you will never end up covering any of the content. And you can still have them visually attached to the content when it's large enough, which I prefer aesthetically. And when it gets small enough, you offset them out, and you get the best of both worlds, and nothing collides with one another at all. So it's another one of those small, incremental UI refinements that I think comes from really trying to keep questioning those existing implementation, even if you've seen them 100 times before, try to remain curious about them. And I think that's just really, really valuable and really fun as well to try to find those incremental improvements. And if I can leave you with this one last little thing, it would be to try to allow yourself more often to reinvent the wheel and counterintuitively as it may seem, kind of go back and rebuild things, build things for your own that you haven't built before, even if they exist in 100 forms already. Not necessarily to create a better version of it, but to learn what really went into making it, what all the factors are, what the options are to do it differently, and why it wasn't done differently. Thank you.